So here's a problem from complex numbers. We're given a quadratic equation where the coefficients, the a, b, and c, are all real numbers. Okay? And we're told that z satisfies the quadratic equation, right? What we're asked to do is show that the conjugate of z, z bar, is also a solution to star. Okay, now on the surface that might seem easy and kind of trivial, but why would you want to do that, right? Well, if you're solving equations and you have one solution, immediately you know the second solution. So it saves you time. If you have one solution to one complex solution to a quadratic equation, then you can immediately write down a second solution, the conjugate. Okay, so it saves you time, right? So let me just sort of remind ourselves of what this conjugate means, right? So if I'm working in the imaginary plane, or look at the complex plane, sorry, and I have, say, a complex number there. To get the conjugate, you just reflect it in the real axis, okay, the horizontal axis. Okay, and algebraically, if z is alpha plus beta I, then z bar would be alpha minus beta I. So you look at the coefficient of I and you change the sign on it. Okay? All right, so there's a couple of ways of doing it. One way would be to actually plug z bar equals alpha minus bi into here for x and expand it. But that would take a lot of, you know, messing around. The easiest and the quickest way to do it is just use the conjugate. Okay, so I'm going to talk about that, and I'm going to go through it in a bit of detail. Okay, so since by assumption z satisfies star, we have the following. Right, we have az squared plus bz plus c equals zero. I'm going to call that, you guessed it, double star. All right? So we're going to take the conjugate of both sides of double star, and then we're going to use the properties of the conjugate, which are kind of cool. Okay? So taking conjugates of both sides of double star, and we're going to apply the properties of the conjugate. There's lots of them, but I'll go through them step by step. All right, so what are we going to obtain here? Well, I'm going to take the conjugate of both sides, right? So on the left hand, on the right hand side, the conjugate of zero, the conjugate of a real number, is just itself. So the conjugate of zero is zero. Okay, and then I can work on this side. Okay, so I'm taking the conjugate of the whole thing. Now, we know this is going to be zero, and here we've got some sort of, we want to break that down, right? So the conjugate of a sum is the sum of the conjugates. Okay? So if I was to add another sort of line over here, I can break this up into, okay, I'm being very careful now. The conjugate of a sum of complex numbers is the sum of the conjugates. That's all it is. Okay, I can even go a bit further now. Here I've got products and powers. Okay, the conjugate of a product is equal to the product of the conjugates. Okay, so we've got this power here, but we'll deal with that in a minute. Okay, so I'm being very careful here. Now, the conjugate of a real number, C is real, remember, is just itself. The conjugate of a real number is just itself, right? So conjugate C is C. Again, A bar and B bar are going to be A and B because A and B are both real. And the only thing I've got to worry about now is this conjugate of a power. Conjugate of Z squared. Well, again, the conjugate laws tell us that this is the square of the conjugate. The conjugate of the square is the square of the conjugate. So to sort of, let me start that again. So I'm going to put that in there and put brackets around it to make sure we get that. Okay, so we know that that's zero, the conjugate of zero, zero. So we know that this becomes the following. So what do we mean? What do we know then? Well, we know that Z bar satisfies star. Right, so a good question here is, well, what's the point? Why would I want to do something like that? I've already talked about time-saving techniques. And a good question here is, and this is part three of this question, actually, do the ideas generalize? Okay, so there's two ways of generalizing this setting. The first is to take a more complicated polynomial. So here we've got a quadratic. What about a cubic equation or a quartic equation? Okay, if the coefficients of, say, that cubic or that quartic equation are all real and you have one solution, is the conjugate still a solution? And the answer is yes, it is. Okay, there's another way to generalize this. And let's just keep it in the quadratic equation case. What happens if A, B, or C were complex numbers and you have one solution? Is the conjugate still a solution to that problem? Not necessarily. So let me just write something in down here. Consider, I'm just going to choose a simple one, z squared plus iz equals zero. Okay, here's a quadratic equation where the coefficient of z, or x, whatever you want to write down, is complex, right? It's I. Now, I don't have to do anything special to that. I can factorize it. So what are my solutions going to be? 0 and negative I. Now 0 and negative I are not the conjugates of each other, right? So therefore, if we change the coefficients here to complex numbers, the idea no longer works. Okay, well, not necessarily. They are not conjugates. Or conjugate pairs. Okay, so we can generalize this to polynomial equations with real coefficients of any degree, But if the coefficients are complex, the idea doesn't necessarily work.